coming up.
Thank you very, very much. I'm delighted to be here. I have not seen George Soros in over 36 years, so you might as well ask me about my first wife or about where I went to college or something. Soros and I have nothing to do with each other at all, and have not for a few decades.
Good.
I am certainly delighted to be here. My first libertarian vote was for Fran Youngstein in 1973. Is there anybody here from New York?
Hey, New Jersey.
That's, well, Fran Youngstein ran for mayor of New York in 1973, and that was my first libertarian vote. I go back to when Ed Clark and David Koch were running, and Ron Clark was running. Ron Paul was running. All the Ron Paul kids and family came to my house at one time. So I'm very delighted to be here. I'm flattered to be here. I'm surprised to be here. It's a long way from where I live now. But before we go further, I want to take you all back, since I've gone back far in time now. I want to take you back to 1856. Is there anybody here who remembers the election of 1856?
Not Lincoln.
Buchanan. 1856, a sitting president of the U.S. could not get the nomination of his own party, the Democratic Party. His name was Franklin Pierce. He was replaced as the nominee by James Buchanan. A new party was ran for the first time. It was a Republican Party. They had never run before. They nominated John Fremont, who had never run for any office at all. And there was a third party, which was then known as the American Party. It used to be the Whig Party. It, too, was headed by a former president, Millard Fillmore. And the one who won was James Buchanan, who had happened to be the ambassador to the UK. I bring all this up because there was a lot of turmoil in American presidential politics in those days, because the country was facing some huge problems: free trade, immigration, slavery. And there was so much turmoil that two former U.S. presidents could not get nominated or elected. And the reason I bring that up is because the bad news, I'll give you bad news and good news. The bad news is America's on the verge of total disaster again. I hope it's not a civil war like it was after the next election from 1856. But America's facing a huge collapse. We will have horrible economic problems after the next election, probably, in fact, caused by whoever wins the next election. I hope that the Libertarians actually don't win in November, because if they do, they will be blamed for the problems. But the second point is that after the next election, the whole political frontier, the whole political situation in the U.S. is going to change very, very dramatically. There's some parties after the 1856 election disappeared, others became radically different. So that's going to happen again soon in America. It doesn't matter whether Mrs. Clinton wins. She will lead to bankruptcy and war slowly. Donald Trump, of course, will lead to bankruptcy and war quickly. So either way, we have a problem. I don't want you to predict which one other will win, because the results are going to be the same. Absolute nightmare for the U.S. economy, U.S. foreign relations situation. So we have big problems facing us. That's the bad news. The good news is that leaves great opportunities for libertarians and the future of the Libertarian Party. You know, when I grew up here in the U.S. in the 40s and 50s and 60s, this was the land of the free still. Now, unfortunately, we're no longer the land of the free, as many of you know. They know what you're doing in your garage, in your bedroom, in your bank account. They know everything you're doing, and they probably don't like what you're doing, whatever it is you're doing, because this is no longer the land of the free. You certainly don't have the Fourth Amendment anymore. They can knock down your door whenever they want to, according to the Supreme Court. You can do anything according to the Supreme Court. There's not much freedom of religion anymore. Second Amendment, of course, they try to take more and more away every day. Freedom of speech is a mere shadow of its former self. America has troops in over 100 countries around the world, making enemies, not doing anything to the security of the U.S., but making many, many enemies all over the world. So it's not a good situation here. Our schools are not very good anymore. You know, in America, we don't even finish in the top 20. Our kids don't in the schools. Our health care, we spend more on health care than everybody in the world, and yet we have not even in the top 20 as far as results from health care. You know, we have a gigantic litigation disaster in the U.S., which other countries don't have. I was reading today, because I'm just about to get on a plane tomorrow, that over 70,000 passengers of American Airlines missed flights in the last year because we've been protected by the TSA. That doesn't happen in other countries. I travel all over the world every month, and I assure you, in other countries, the TSA equivalent works. I've never heard of anybody missing a flight. I'm sure there have been people, but not 70,000 by one airline. So the whole thing is falling apart around us. Education, litigation, military. We claim we're the world's great superpower. Maybe we are, because there's nobody else. But we have trouble even winning wars in countries like Syria and Iraq, etc. now. So we're not what we used to be when we were the land of the free. We have the gigantic tax problem, as you all know. I've never quite seen anything like it. If any of you try to pay your taxes, a certain amount are that thick, mainly because of absurd requirements, reporting requirements. It's almost impossible for an American to open a bank account abroad now. I just today got thrown out of another bank where I've had an account for a long time. It's not just me. I happen to be an American, a citizen of the land of the free, and I cannot have a bank account in yet another foreign country. They don't like us very much anymore. It's not that they don't like us, it's Washington, D.C. that they don't like. So we've got a gigantic problem in this country. The good news is it's falling apart, and that's going to give great opportunities to us, because when this whole thing collapses, and it's going to collapse soon, we will be at the right place at the right time, and all of us will have had foresight. And if you haven't read about the election of 1856, go back and do so, because you can see that the country was having huge political problems and changes and shifts because they knew that something was wrong. There was something wrong in 1856. We're not going to have a big war over slavery. I hope we're not going to have a war over anything. That war was largely because of free trade. It was disguised as slavery, but it was a free trade war. It started as a free trade war anyway. So we're not going to have that kind of war, I hope, but we're certainly going to have disaster. So I hope that all of you are informed. I hope that all of you are very worried. And I hope that you're getting prepared, because it's going to be disaster. And those of us who survive, Libertarian Party especially, will come out the other side in very good shape. So I think I should stop. I could talk all night, but I don't want to. If any of you have any questions of me, I'm happy to take questions about anything, including the election of 1856, or anything else you want to discuss. And if not, yes.
Some people say that Lincoln was the first third-party candidate to win the presidency. Other people say, no, he wasn't a third-party. What do you think about that?
Well, the question, what is your name, please?
Will Tyler White.
Where are you from?
Michigan.
Will Tyler White asked about whether Lincoln was the first third-party candidate. Well, given that...
To be elected.
Well, given that there was no Republican Party before the 1856 election, that ran in a national election, and the main parties up until then were the Whigs and the Democrats, and along came this party called the Republicans. They finished second in 1856, and then when the Democrats split in 1860, they won. I guess it would be. I don't know who else you would say would be the first third party candidate to win.
I would agree with that.
I don't think there's been a successful third party candidates since then. No, there hasn't been. So think back to 1856. It led to 1860 with a dramatic shift.
I'm John from Pennsylvania.
This is John from Pennsylvania.
You're expecting a collapse shortly. Does that rule out a Cyprus-style confiscation by our own central bank? Why would you rule that out?
The question was about the disaster and the... Daniel, can you...
Daniel.
Oh, someone.
Here.
Can you give this to the next questioner, please?
Sure.
Yes, when the disaster comes, they're probably going to confiscate maybe not our bank accounts at first, but they will probably take away our 401k plans. They will say they're doing it for your own good. We're not going to be able to make any money in the stock market. So they say, well, we will take your 401k plan. We will give you government bonds for your own good. And that's one way they will finance the gigantic deficits will only get worse. As far as bank accounts, they have changed the law so that it's now legal for a bank to take your money. That's legal. Not legal last time around, but now most countries in the world have changed it so it's legal to take your money out of your bank account for your own good.
So if they get away with that in the next election, they might be able to kick the can far enough down the road?
Well, they hope. Yes, when the things collapse again, they'll take your 401, they'll take your pensions, they may take some of your bank accounts. That will help recover one more time, but it will be such a shock and such a disaster that there will be a political upheaval and shifts, and certainly the one election after that will be great opportunities for anybody new and fresh.
Yes. Mr. Rogers, my name is Pete from Niceville. I'd like to ask you about...
Pete from where?
Pete from Niceville.
Niceville?
Niceville, yeah, and it is a nice place.
Nice, what state?
Florida.
Oh,
in the
okay.
Panhandle. I'd like to go ahead and ask you about the war on cash. I'd like to go ahead and ask you, is it real and what does it mean for us?
There's a very real war on cash, Pete. Governments don't want you to have cash anymore because if everything is on your computer, on their computer, then they know everything you have done and it will be easier for them to take your money away from you. It will also be easier for them to put you in jail, whether you deserve to be in jail or not. If you drink too many cups of coffee, they'll say, this guy Pete drinks too much coffee. There's something wrong with him. So yes, there is a serious war on cash, and the way electronics are developing, it will make it possible for them to know everything soon. And they want to get rid of cash because they don't like cash. Because they can't control it.
I believe Singapore did a public service thing against cash in the mid-80s, by the way.
No, they still have cash. I live in Singapore.
But I know, but I mean, they did a public service type thing to decrease the use of cash.
They may have. I wasn't there in the 80s. There's no restriction on cash.
Sure,
now.
Right.
In Singapore. Well, if there are no more, sorry, go ahead.
Steve Baker from Minnesota.
Sorry, what is your name?
Steve Baker.
Okay. I don't think they can hear you, Steve.
Now hold the mic close to your mouth.
Close to your mouth, yeah. You're there.
Now can you hear me?
Yeah.
All right. Steve Baker from Minnesota. No question, just a comment. I flew down here yesterday. I checked my bag. I got down here, got to my hotel room. There was a note inside my bag. The TSA had opened it anyway.
Oh yeah, don't think that this is not the land of the free anymore. I don't know when you were growing up in Minnesota, but this is not the country that we used to live in. I've had my mail opened by the U.S. government. I'm sure you're not the only person who had his bag opened by the U.S. government. No, they can do all of that. I don't know if they can do all of that, and they do. As I said, they can come into your garage, they can come into your bank, they can come into your bedroom and do anything you want. And they do.
Matt Chalko from Virginia. So given all the doom and gloom, what one or two things do you think would make sense to protect one's personal wealth?
Passport.
Well, everybody should only invest in things they know about. You should not listen to me or the internet or TV or anything else. You should only invest in what you know a lot about. I own some gold. I have investments in other countries. Everybody should certainly diversify to another country with some of their assets. You probably have an insurance policy. Do it as an insurance policy, if nothing else. You have fire insurance. You hope you never use it. Use your international investments the same way. And there are great opportunities for making money elsewhere. You'll have some of your money out of the country. If you know how to farm, buy yourself a farm, or invest in agriculture, gold, I'm not buying gold and silver at the moment. I certainly own gold.
Are you buying Bitcoin?
I'm not buying Bitcoin. The world needs something to compete with currencies, and everything is going to be electronic eventually. Bitcoin may be okay. I don't know whether gold will be better or Bitcoin. Not Bitcoin itself, probably, but something like Bitcoin. So those are some of the things I am doing. I hope I protect myself. I hope I survive.
Familiar with bullion vault along the lines of getting assets out?
Oh, sorry. How you doing, Jim? Adam Kokesh, Arizona. As someone as well-traveled as yourself and versed in the issues of freedom around the world, I want to ask about what you think about a mobile lifestyle versus a stationary lifestyle. And we see in the United States, especially among retired people, people retiring to live in RVs. And in contrast, people living in a homesteading lifestyle in order to accumulate wealth and live more free and be off-grid independent. From your perspective, considering you've lived the extremes of both part of that spectrum and seen the hazards on both sides and the benefits on both sides, is there something you would either recommend or how you see that relating to the greater sense of human progress towards greater freedom?
Well, my wife says that I'm a nomad, that I'm not a real person. I'm a nomad who loves to be somewhere else. What you just asked is a wonderful question. I cannot make that decision for anybody. Leaving your own country, leaving your own state is hard for most people, but to leave your own country is very difficult. If you're an American citizen, you have to pay taxes wherever you are. Even if you never come to the U.S. and have no assets in the U.S., you still have to pay American taxes. Now, more and more people are giving up their American citizenship, you know, and if you plan your life right, I know people who pay no taxes, who don't even file tax returns. They spend 3 months here, 4 months there, 4 months at the other place, out of their own, and that's legal. Legal in most countries. It's only in America that that's not legal. In nearly every country in the world, if you don't live in the country, if you don't earn any money in the country, you don't have to pay taxes. And as I said, I know a lot of people who totally legally don't even file tax returns because they move, they spend 3 or 4 months here, 3 or 4 months there. I know one guy's got 3 houses, so he never has to file a tax return. Now, if you want that lifestyle, you certainly make a lot more money.
What country does that guy live in? What country does the guy with the 3 houses live in?
There's a 3 of them.
He lives in 3 different countries. He lives in Britain, he lives in France, and he lives in the Cayman Islands.
And not the U.S.
No, not the U.S. Listen, the U.S., this is the land of the free, ain't the land of the free anymore. I don't particularly like saying it since I'm an American citizen, taxpayer, and voter, but it's a fact.
Hi, my name is Benjamin Strupp, and I'm from North Carolina. I had a question. You were mentioning that you were invested in other countries outside of the United States. Why do you see those countries as more free than the United States?
There are two parts of that question. Not necessarily more free, but perhaps more profitable than the U.S. You can be not necessarily a terribly free country and still have great profits. Right now, I would like to invest in North Korea. North Korea is one of the most exciting countries in the world. It's changing very, very rapidly. Don't listen to American propaganda. It's listening, it's changing. But it's not a very free country, as you and I would define freedom. But if you want, it's like investing in China in 1981. You'd be the richest person in this state if you'd invested in China in 1981. And if you can find a legal way to invest in North Korea now, you'll be the richest person in North Carolina.
So where are you investing?
Well, I have investments in China, I have investments in Russia, I have sold short the U.S., I have investments in agriculture, in various countries around the world, Vietnam, where I've invested, various countries around the world. But don't invest where I'm investing, invest where you know, not me.
I want to know.
keep it quick.
I'm Daniel Hayes from New Orleans, Louisiana. Mr. Rogers, what do you think the Libertarian Party needs to do to become a more effective force in American politics?
That's an extraordinarily good question. I tell you, my first vote was for the Libertarians in 1973 for Fran Youngstein when she was running for mayor of New York. And I've asked myself that many, many times, because the philosophy, the message, is the best there is, the way everybody should live. And I don't know why others don't understand it. And clearly, some of us have not done a great job of explaining it to other people. What I said was that after this election, we're going to have many, many more opportunities. Because right now, I tell you, either one of them, whoever wins, is going to ruin the country. And then people are going to say, what do we do now? You know, Hillary Clinton's negatives are over 60%. Over 60% of Americans have a negative view of Hillary Clinton. Donald Trump's are even higher. And over 70% of people think Donald Trump. So you're going to have, I mean, this is an unbelievable, I mean, if you said to a country, anybody in the world, you know, in America, two people are running for president. One is hated by 60% and one is hated by 70%. They would not comprehend. I cannot comprehend, but it's a fact. So whatever happens, it's going to give us an opportunity, because then they're going to be looking for something else. And I don't have an answer, Daniel. I'm sure somebody in this room does. I hope somebody in this room does. But how we get that, how people, just explain it to people. You explain it to people, most people say, ah, that sounds good. But unfortunately, some of, we have not been able to explain it, at least in 40 years.
Jim, John Sir from Ohio. Manufacturing is basically deflationary. Capitalism is basically deflationary because business people are always trying to reduce the human and material inputs. So how can we change, should we change this paradigm that we always have to have inflation? Can't we work on low cost for the individual?
Well, at the end of the 19th century, we had, for 25 or 30, after this war between the states, we had serious deflation for a long time. And that was because the railroads opened up vast lands, manufacturing exploded, boom, so prices came down a lot. And so we had horrible deflation. But America became the richest country in the world because of the railroads and opening up the new lands, etc. Immigration. We begged people to come to America. We gave them land if they would come to America, as long as they worked for land, if they were productive people. So deflation is not necessarily bad. China has brought a lot of deflation to the world. But you have cheaper shoes, cheaper belts, cheaper everything because of what's happened in China. So don't worry. For most of history, people have tried to prevent inflation. Destroying the currency has not been a good thing for most of human history. The Romans ruined their currency. Many countries have ruined their currencies, you know. And that's why gold has always been, it's always held its value. So you're not worrying about deflation. It's inflation when they start destroying your currency. That's what happened to Germany. That's what happened to many countries. They destroy the currency. You wipe out the people who save and invest for the future. And then the country goes to hell.
So the Fed's basically a con job at The Fed is basically a con job then, as far as the inflation?
The central bank, it's a hopeless con job. The good news is, in America, we've had three central banks. The first two disappeared for whatever reason. This one's going to disappear too, because they're such a hopeless bunch of know-nothings. They have no clue what they're doing. They're all Ivy League educated know-nothings. Don't worry, Federal Reserve will disappear. I told you it's going to be chaos and disaster. That's going to be part of it. Yes.
Hi, thanks for coming out. My question was, where are you from? My name's Andrew. I'm from Florida here over in Newport News.
Jesus.
My main question was, in all your years of, you know, fighting bad ideas, what would you say is the best tactic we can use to communicate this idea, to make it attractive to people and actually change people's minds?
The libertarian idea?
Yes.
Well, as I said before, I have pondered that for over 40 years. if I had an answer, I would have done something besides vote and contribute. I think we are going to have a receptive audience after the disaster. And then somehow, maybe the people at headquarters in Virginia will come up with a way to make people listen. Once they listen, or once we can find someone who can actually explain it to them, then most people say, where have you been all my life? I like this. I like this. But unfortunately, I have not explained it very well. None of us have. You come up with an answer, and you will change the world. Somebody's going to change the world.
That's what I'm working on.
Working on? Very good. In how? That means very good.
Are there others who have questions? If you do come up here, and you get an opportunity to share them with our speaker, as well as with our fellow libertarians. If not, I'm going to take advantage of your man.
Hi, I'm Lynn Albright from New York. My question is, you mentioned North Korea as a good investment.
Okay, where are you from?
New York.
New York City?
New York.
Okay.
You mentioned North Korea as a good investment, and I find it, I was shocked, to be honest, because isn't there a moral component there? I mean, the way they run their country? Or is there something I'm missing here?
Well, if I had said to you in 1981 you should invest in China, you probably would have said the same thing.
Yeah, I would.
And there was a gigantic change taking place. The Chinese have brought more people out of poverty into middle class or even wealth in the past 35 years. Now, if you're going to say, Mao Zedong, how could you ever have invested in China in 1981? I didn't, but I wish I had. Mao Zedong was dead in 1981. Mao Zedong was no longer running the country, and the country's been opening up and changing for the better. I find that good if you're encouraging and helping positive change. When I first went to China 32 years ago, there was only one radio, one TV, one way to dress. Nothing. Now there are over 50,000 demonstrations in China every year that we know about, probably 200,000. Many radios, many media, many TVs, internet is everywhere. Is that good that China's changed dramatically? Or should we never invest in China in 1981, or two, or three, or four? Now that's what North Korea is doing now. I suggest to you that if you can get involved with something to encourage and help the change, you're better off. Maybe you would have said in 1790, you're not going to invest in America because of their horrible civil war. Everybody in Europe said this was a terrible place. Everybody said this was a terrible place. Should you have invested in America in 1790? You saw the changes. You probably would have said they were positive changes. I'm not suggesting we should have invested with Joseph Stalin, but after Joseph Stalin, and after changes started taking place in Russia and other places, those countries got better. The people went to Myanmar a few years ago. Everybody there wanted me to invest. The American government said you cannot because it's a moral situation. But all the people in Myanmar were desperate for foreigners to come in and help them change. So I suggest to you, you have to make your own decision, that if you can invest in a place where it is opening up and getting better, they're happier. You, being a moral, upright citizen, helping positive change take place. If you wait for the positive change to take place, if you wait till now to invest in China, you miss 30 years. 30 years of improvement, and the Chinese are very, very happy not to be living in 1976 anymore. Go to Russia. They're very, very happy. None of the Russians want the Berlin Wall to come back. Nobody in Russia is eager to have the Berlin Wall again. It's all opening and changing.
Yeah, well, that's a good answer. That's a very interesting answer, and I
you don't have to listen to me. You make your own.
No, I do think it's a good point. It's a problem.
Quick follow-up question. So why are you shorting America? Is it to make money? Don't you want to invest in America and turn it around? If America is the new North Korea?
I wish America was the new North Korea. America was the land of the free, and America's going the other way now. California's more communist than China. You know, Massachusetts is more communist than Russia now. Those countries are opening up and getting better and better. Maybe you think that America is getting better and better and better economically. I mean, we could talk about, I talked philosophically. The American stock market's at all-time high. Chinese stock market is down 60%. I'm sure your parents taught you to buy low and sell high. Well, America's here because of a lot of money printing by the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve prints staggering amounts of money, keeps the stock market up. The economy's going down. That's why I'm short the American stock market.
Hello, I'm James.
I mean, I didn't mean I'm right. Listen, I've lost money. I've made many mistakes in my life.
My name is James Holland from San Antonio, Texas.
San Antonio.
And I've been wondering in my head lately, everyone talks about the end of America and how the economy is going to collapse. It seems like it never does. Is it not possible that we could go struggling along for decade after decade in just some kind of a European, just poor economy for a really long time and never really have that collapse that everyone seems to be predicting?
In 1918, the UK was the richest, most powerful country in the world. There was no number two in 1918. The U.S. was rising, but we were still these crazy people out there in the West. But the U.K. was corroded from within. The U.K. is still there, but it's not even in the top 25 countries economically anymore. It's got gigantic debts, and it continues to decline as a deteriorate. It's still there. I'm sure the U.S. will still be here in 100 years. Maybe not as we know it anyway. So you don't have to disappear. Spain was once the richest country in the world. It's still there, but that was 500 years ago. The Dutch, the Netherlands were fabulously rich once upon a time. You've heard the expression, Dutch uncle? That is because the Dutch used to be so rich, and everybody wanted a Dutch uncle who would come in and take care of them. But they're no longer, you don't want a Dutch uncle anymore, you want a Chinese uncle, American uncle. You don't want a Dutch uncle anymore.
Michael Cloud from Tucson, Arizona. You have traveled a number of countries to invest in. Of all the countries you've visited, you've had the opportunity to go see, which are scenic enough that if the investment doesn't turn so good, at least we had a good trip?
There's many kinds of Argentina. Argentina is an astonishing country, scenic-wise. It's got everything. Australia, New Zealand. There are countries that are, most countries actually have, most fairly mixed countries, have extraordinary scenery. Singapore doesn't. I live in Singapore. Singapore is tiny. It has good scenery, but now go to Russia. Go to, which is opening up dramatically. Go to Argentina, go to Australia, go to New Zealand. I'm not going to any of them, but those are countries.
Okay. I'm going to Venezuela, though.
But no, maybe Venezuela, because he's going to die soon. Somebody's going to die in Venezuela. And Venezuela has fantastic scenery if you can make it through the problems. Zimbabwe is spectacular. And Mr. Mugabe's going to die sometime. Well, he says he's not going to die. But if Mr. Mugabe dies, Zimbabwe will be a great place to be. And Venezuela, too. So Venezuela has fabulous women. They're always winning a beauty contest.
Great cuisine, too.
Great cuisine, great everything.
Hey, Jim. This is Andrew Ben from Newport Richey, Florida. My main question is, well, from my point of view, I highly favor entrepreneurship over political action as a way to change things and cause, betterment in our world. Now, you've obviously done very well for yourself.
My main question would be, in your business life, what are maybe two or three core values that you've used as your guiding compass to get you where you are today? Thanks.
Well, I have a couple of daughters who are very important, the most important to me, and I'm trying to teach them to think independently, not to follow the crowd, think for you, and first be very curious. When you hear something, you say, wait a minute, is that true or not? Think independently. Think for yourself, uncover all the rocks that you can, and to beware of boys. That's what I'm trying to teach my girls.
Are there any others that have questions of Jim Rogers? Going once.
Right here.
All right.
Last question.
This is going to be a good one, right? Okay.
Hi, Jim. Question. Do you think this is going to be a belligerent bull?
What is your name?
I'm Max Dixon. You may know my father. My father is Mark Bruce Dixon, Dixon Partners. You may have heard of him.
Where are you from?
I'm from New York City.
That's a place.
Small little place. Anyway, do you think this is going to be a bullish or a bearish year for gold? A bullish or a bearish year for gold?
For gold?
Yeah.
I own gold, as I showed you before. I own silver too. I'd rather buy sugar than gold at the moment. I am not bound to gold. If gold goes under 1,000, which I suspect it will, then I will buy gold. I hope I'm smart enough to buy a lot more gold. In the meantime, I'm not selling my gold. If gold goes up from here, I never buy another ounce. I have plenty. My expectation, though, is that I will have another chance to buy gold.
So that would seem to imply that you were kind of in a QE1, QE2 bubble, and it's a long way down, it seems like you're saying a bit.
Well, there comes a time when either the central banks come to their senses, which is unlikely, or that the market just says, we don't want your garbage anymore. We're not going to play. You keep printing, we'll give it back to you.
Thank you. Anyone else? Going once.
Right here.
Where? This guy's got a good one.
Hey, Jim. My name is Gabe. I run Gabe. Gabriel.
Where are you from?
From Florida. Tampa.
Tampa.
Yeah. So I run a Bitcoin meetup, and I'm really bullish on Bitcoin. I was wondering to get your take on Bitcoin.
Well, I said before that the world is desperate for a new monetary system. This one's falling apart, mainly because the U.S. dollar is unbelievably flawed currency. The U.S. dollar is the largest debtor nation in the history of the world. Many people are trying to find other replacements. The Russians and the Chinese and other countries are starting to try to find a replacement, or at least someone to compete with the U.S. dollar. So the world needs something. It's probably going to be on the computer because everything is electronic now. My kids will never go to a post office. My kids will never go to a bank. So it's all going to be on electronic. Whether it's Bitcoin or not, I don't know. Probably, I don't think it will be. That's partly because I don't know what I'm talking about. I don't know enough about Bitcoin. It will be on the computer though. And they will do away with cash. They may make it impossible to have gold as well. They won't take the gold away from you. They'll just say you cannot use gold as money. And then what good is gold at that point, except for your teeth? I own no Bitcoin. I own plenty of gold and silver. You can give me all the Bitcoin you want. You know, by all means, I'll take it. I'll swap you some silver.
Is there anyone who has the last question for Jim Rogers? Going once, going twice?
Should I bring up the big
then, ladies and gentlemen of the Libertarian Party, please give a warm thank you to a man who should be Secretary of the Treasury.